Frank Holmes, CEO of U.S. Global Investors, thank you so much for being here with me at the Denver Gold Forum.
It's great being here with you at Mile High.
Really high altitudes, right. But you were breathing okay so
That's
far.
Right.
Okay, last time you were on, you broke the internet with your call. People were like, wow, Frank Holmes is calling for $10,000 gold, because you never really came out with such a big number.
And I said, why not?
And you said, why not? And you know what? It doesn't seem so crazy anymore when I'm talking to other people. Rob McEwen was on, and he one-upped that call by saying that if you apply historical multiples of price growth during bull runs, gold should be anywhere between 8,000 to 21,000. So, Frank, do you think that the current economic environment is comparable to 2011 or 2008 or the late 70s when gold saw major breakouts?
Well, I think also very important is Pierre Lassonde, and his methodology is between 5,000 and 25,000. I think the 10,000 is going to also, not because the world's coming to an end, I think all those great Andy Warhol prints are going to go up also spectacularly well. I think that real assets, when you have zero interest rates and you don't have the discipline by governments to change their fiscal policies, they just think by making money cheap, it shows up in real assets. And we're going to get this surge in inflation. When it happens, I don't know, but I do know there is big inflation in real assets.
Well, and that's a good point. And isn't that a case for gold itself? Because obviously there's an obvious war of countries racing to devalue their currencies here. So is that not in itself a case for gold?
Absolutely. And there's peak supply. So there's not really new supply coming on. There's been no significant discoveries. There's no, like when I started in the business at Hemlo, there's nothing. And then we had Nevada that built Barrick. And then we had Eskay Creek up in northern BC. There was none of these big discovery camps and driving.
Yeah, we haven't seen. What's the last great gold discovery we've seen?
I think that supplies is peaking. And I think that rising GDP, what's very different than 1980 is Chindia. Because China, India, affectionately known as Chindia, is 40% of the world's population. And the GDP per capita of Chindia is now quickly growing to top the world. So you take a look at the numbers, they're with America. So there's something significant happening there, and they have a cultural affinity for buying gold, where I come up with the love trade. Why I love Manet, because it's a product there that helping people be able to buy 24 karat gold jewelry without a big markup. Because the cultural affinity is so important. So I think that that's very, very significant difference. And now we have this currency devaluation, inflation. I printed a piece on this in Target and Walmart. It's 5%. Go buy something, it's 5%. Now with this oil scare in Saudi Arabia, then we could easily track around for the oil pump. So we could turn around and easily get numbers going for the consumer where they buy something 7-8%.
Well, I'm happy you brought that up. And yes, you did say in our earlier talk that we don't need an outright war for gold to get to that number. So looking at the news over the weekend about Saudi Arabia, and you sent me a lot of good news stories and research offline, and thank you for that. Did you think it was going to move gold more, or is it just going to take time here?
I think it takes time. I think that if we go, there is a war that breaks out from something like this, then that will drive gold because there's even more money printing. What's amazing about America, we have unprecedented deficits with no war and no recession. What happens when you get a recession or you get a war, you get this incredible money printing that gold goes up in that currency. So what if something does break out, gold's then going to really start to rocket because of currency devaluation.
But this is really scary times. And in the research you sent me, it showed how this is worse than if Canada shut down all its oil reserves, and it's the world's fourth largest producer of oil. Do you think that we're getting real news out of Saudi Arabia?
I think you're getting real news, but the real big issue is Saudi Arabia is what the fifth biggest spender of military. It makes it really difficult that this type of drone or whatever can fly in so easily and blow them up and they don't know where with all the satellite imagery. Something's not right in that narrative. I don't know what it is, but I do know the fact that natural gas is becoming much more significant. And the frackers have really, the U.S. innovation on fracking for energy is a big game changer. So I think that's another reason why oil didn't go to 120.
Frank, finally, let's talk mining. We're at a mining show. And you've come to do your homework, right? You've come to scope out companies that you like. What do you feel the sentiment's like in the mining space? Yeah.
It's very bullish. Remember the data points last night at dinner?
Yeah.
There's something like 60 analysts that have not been here for 5 years. There's 300 buyers of money managers that are here. That's a big audience. That's representing complexes of trillions of dollars of money management. So I think that's a pretty bullish. But the real separation for me is those that have good quant math.
And that's who you want in your in your portfolio, right? And,
what do I like?
Yes.
What do I like?
Nice.
I love free cash flow. I love free cash flow. And math says if companies can have free cash flow, you listen to Nico's presentation, they have negative, they're going towards free. What shocked me though is when I looked at the 108 gold producers around the world we track, in fact, they on average have negative cash flow, free cash flow. But the cash flow returns on invested capital, the world as a whole, is running around 13% today. So I'm looking at all those companies here that are twice that. And then profit margins. The world's profit margins are averaging 17%. I'm looking for companies with twice that. So it's really interesting to see that the number of companies of the 108 really come down to around 20 names that are being able to deliver those free cash flow and revenue last quarter above four quarters, that momentum and cash flow, that's where
so
I'm looking.
So cash is still king.
Cash is always king.
Because from from the run up from 1250 to 1500, obviously a lot of the miners have a lot more cash here. And if they're not in M&A activity or looking to acquire, do you feel that they should start being more generous with their shareholders? It's not a sector that's been known to pay dividends, but do you think that's something we should be seeing more of?
Paying dividends? Yes, absolutely. It creates a discipline, especially if they have free cash flow.
They don't do it enough. Do you think that will change?
They don't do it enough. I think it's going to change because they're going to become has-beens. Like the quant world is much bigger than myself as a group of gold fund managers. The generalists are substantially bigger. What do they look for is different than what the gold stock analyst narrative is. So I am looking at those factors that drive a bigger audience of buying.
Frank Holmes of US Global Investors. It's always a pleasure. We'll speak to you soon.
Yes.
We'll speak to you probably next week. So thank you so
much. From your lips to God's ears.
Yeah, thank you so much, Frank. And thank you for watching. We will have much more for you from the Denver Gold Forum.